Soldiers of the Cross, the terrible war in Europe leads on to what the Bible styles the battle of the great day of God Almighty. The scriptures tell us there will be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, and that so fierce will be the contest and the resulting anarchy that unless those days are cut short, no flesh will survive. But they tell us that those days will be cut short by the establishment of Messiah's kingdom, which will bring in everlasting peace and be the desire of all nations. Then they will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks and will learn war no more. Thank God for all this. Soldiers of the Cross were not enlisted to injure fellow men, but to do good unto all. How are we heeding our captain's command? How near are we to the firing line of doing good to all? Are we searchers in neglecting the glorious opportunities of standing up for Jesus, for the truth, for the kingdom of God, even to the laying down of our lives? Or are we overcharged with the affairs of this life and the deceitfulness of riches and neglecting the due call, forgetting that the duty of the hour is to show forth the praises of Him who has called us out of darkness into His marvelous light? Is it possible that any Christian soldiers are standing for error, professing what they do not believe, or supporting errors with money or with influence? Alas, it would so appear. We cannot hope that those who search or are disloyal will get the peace reward and hear the joyful words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joys of thy Lord and share the dominion of the kingdom of righteousness." The Bible has forewarned us that the present time is one of extreme danger to the soldiers of the cross, because it will be such an outward form of godliness without its power that they will be deceived and for a time stand under the wrong flag, under the sectarian banner. Hearken! Take unto yourselves the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand in the evil day. The evil day is this time in which you are living. But alas, how few Christians seem to be awake and clothed in the armor of God which He has provided in the Bible. How energetic the unprepared should be to put on the helmet, the intellectual appreciation of the divine plan, and the breastplate of righteousness. How great the need for the shield of faith, and for the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, and for the sandals of patient endurance, that we may be able to withstand the fiery darts of the adversary in this evil day. In a very little while, the battle will rage fiercely around every Christian, and the unprepared will be sure to fall. Soon all shall hail our Savior's name. Here we have another grand hymn which most truthfully depicts the Bible message of Messiah's glorious kingdom. Not only will the angels hail Him Lord of all, as they have done since His resurrection and ascension, but according to the scriptures, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess, both those in heaven and those on earth. This hymn seems to be a response to another hymn, "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name." One says, "Let it be so," and the other declares, "It shall be so." The order of the inauguration of the kingdom, as set forth in this hymn, seems to follow closely that laid down in the Bible. First of all will come the resurrection of the church, pointed out by St. Paul, saying, "It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown an animal body, it is raised a spiritual body." Jesus also tells us of the glory of this spiritual body of the church, saying, "Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Here their double office of kings and priests is noted. The office of king is to rule, to control. Jesus will be the great king, the great prophet of that 1,000 years, and his faithful church will be the under-king, under-prophet, cooperating with him in the dominion of the world, for the benefit of mankind, for their uplift out of sin and death conditions. The work of these priests for mankind was foreshadowed in the Jewish priesthood, in their service for Israel. They taught the people the law, and to a large degree were their healers or physicians. So during the millennium, Christ and the Church will not only rule mankind for their good, but also assist them to knowledge after releasing them from the tomb, in proportion as they shall manifest the spirit of obedience to the divine will. How glad we are. But first will come God's blessings to natural Israel, as St. Paul himself clearly portrays in Romans 11th chapter 25th to 32nd verses. Abraham's natural seed have the first opportunity of becoming members of the spiritual seed. Jesus preached the gospel first to them before the door was opened to the Gentiles. Similarly, after the church has been glorified and the time comes for giving the knowledge of the truth to the world in general, it is God's order that this blessing also shall be to the Jew first. Hearken to the apostles' words, and then all Israel shall be saved from blindness and come to a knowledge of the truth.
Son of my soul, few hymns reach down more deeply into the recesses of the heart than this one. Following the line of the 84th Psalm, it pictures the Almighty God as both a son to enlighten and a shield to protect his trustful, obedient children. Our dear Redeemer is also our life and salvation, but he is this as the Father's representative. The Apostle declares, all things are of the Father and by the Son. The Bible represents the child of God as having fellowship with his Father through the merit of the Savior's sacrifice. But it is to the Father that our petitions are addressed, according to Jesus' own counsel. Pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven. And the Master declared that the highest attainment of his followers would be to know the Father thoroughly, intimately, and not without this would they be worthy of everlasting life. This is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. The soul is well developed in the knowledge of his Father, which feels the sentiment of the expression, oh, say no earth-born cloud arise, so hide thee from thy servant's eyes. It is a great fact which all should more and more appreciate, that the child of God cannot be truly happy and spiritually prosperous except as he enjoys the full rights of divine favor. All should know that not only outward sin, but even sympathy with sin, quickly caused the cloud to arise between the Heavenly Father and his child. These clouds are always earthborn, in the sense that they never come from God. They are always the result of some carelessness on the part of the child of God. What Christian cannot appreciate his need of a shield and refuge against the storms of life? How blessed when he can realize, as in this hymn it is expressed, that the Lord is his refuge and fortress, and ever-present help in trouble. Whatever may be the suffering because of obedience to righteousness now, in the grand outworking of God's plan through Messiah's kingdom, every foe must bow, and every sufferer for right doing will be gloriously rewarded. How precious the thought of the third stanza, the grace and glory of the Lord are bestowed upon his faithful children. As the Bible expresses it, we are changed from glory to glory in the likeness of our Lord, as we behold his true likeness set before us in the Holy Scriptures, and as we seek to walk in fellowship of God and to be conformed to the image of his dear Son. No good thing will he withhold from such.
Each hour of prayer. The privilege of prayer to God is a most wonderful one. Apparently few of those who appreciate prayer grasp the full import of the privilege. In prayer, the child of God goes directly into the presence of the great King Eternal and has an audience with his Father through the medium, the advocacy of the glorious Savior. Surely the Christian should not go into the august presence of his Maker in any spirit of levity or in any merely formal way, but only with a reverential appreciation of the greatness of his privilege, of petitioning the Omnipotent One. How inappropriate are the vain repetitions of some who think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. how inappropriate the course of those mentioned to the prophet, who draw nigh unto God with their lips, while their hearts are far from it. Such a course would seem almost blasphemous, an insult to the King Eternal, to seek an audience, to go into his presence, and yet have no real message or business, merely a formality. Is it any wonder that our gracious Heavenly Father, the great ruler of the universe, has made certain limitations, regulations, and requirements which must be observed by all whose petitions he will entertain? Yet note how simple God's requirements. We must have our Redeemer to be our advocate to introduce us. But his introduction will be a lasting one, permitting us to come thereafter every time of need. There is also a requirement as to clothing. We cannot come in the filthy rags of our own righteousness. We must procure a robe clean and white, the robe of Christ's righteousness, the wedding garment to pass toward us into the presence of our God. From what we have seen, it is evident that the great majority who bow the knee in prayer gain no real access to God. Their prayers never really reach him. They approach Jehovah to have an interview without recognizing the appointed rules and regulations. The word says, "We know that God heareth not sinners." Again, Jesus warns, "No man cometh unto the Father but by me." It is well that these limitations be made known to all, for all desire an interest in God, and to have him take an interest in their affairs. But many are deceiving themselves, and Christians have helped the world into this misunderstanding through their ignorance. Let it be known everywhere that prayer is the privilege only of God's consecrated people. Others may worship and bow down and do him homage, but none may make requests in prayer or even offer acceptable praise except the blood washed, the spirit begotten, and their young children. Precious name, oh how sweet. In olden times, a name stood for character or work, thus, "Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." The word Jesus meaning Savior. But the name Jesus has come to have a much larger meaning to the Christian. It not only stands for the mercy of God in the forgiveness of his sins, but also for the blessings, privileges, and opportunities which come solely through the merit of Jesus. As this hymn expresses it, the name of Jesus is precious, both as respects the hopes of earth and the joys of heaven. It is through this name that we have relationship to and standing with the Father, as the Master himself declares, "Without me ye can do nothing." And again, "Whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he will give it to you." Truly, Jesus' name and its influence upon our minds is a shield from every snare. The child of God, realizing his relationship to Jesus, has in that very sentiment a powerful protection as respects evil conduct, evil language, and evil thoughts. When temptations beset, the breathing of that holy name in prayer is sure to bring a helpful influence, drawing us nearer God and chasing away the tempter. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. We are to resist with all our strength, developing more and more in the courage and character. We must also call upon the Lord. Christian hymns and songs should have and do have a powerful influence upon our hearts and lives as Christians for good. Of course, there may be singing without the spirit and without the understanding, mere lip service. God's people should discourage this in every reasonable way. Our hymns, our prayers, our sets of music, and the same sentiments should prevail in our hearts in singing to the Lord as when we go up on our knees. The last verse tells of the praise that shall ascend to God in the name of Jesus throughout the whole world when his victory shall be complete at the close of the millennium. That victory will be one of righteousness over sin, of life over death. This is not the teaching of this beautiful hymn merely, but especially the teaching of the entire Bible. St. Paul declares that it is God's purpose to eventually gather together all things under one head, Jesus. Already he is the head of the church and will be her head, and she is glorified at his right hand at his wheel forevermore. Next in order will come the cherubim, the seraphim, the angelic host, and later perfected mankind restored from sin and death to life everlasting through the merit of Jesus and by the work of the millennial kingdom. The church's one foundation. Gradually, all Christian people are learning not only that there is but one church, but that it comprises all God's true people of every nation and denomination and outside of all denominations. Jesus said, by their fruits you shall know them. We cannot judge the heart, but merely the outward conduct. Our confidence is that the Lord knows them that are his. In a darker time, and not so very long ago, the various churches bearing the names of their governments or founders, each claimed to be the true church and denied the others. Yea, in many, many cases, persecuted them, even to the death. A better, saner thought prevails today, but none of these churches is more than a human institution. Wesley's Church, Calvin's Church, Luther's Church, the Church of Rome, the Church of England, the Greek Church, all are of human origin. Despite their claims, none can show any real connection with the Church of Christ in apostolic times or with its history as recorded in the New Testament writings. The one true Church of Christ is so described in this beautiful hymn as to indicate that the author has gotten his mental eyes open on the subject of precarianism and has come to realize that the one Church of God is that mentioned in the Bible, the Church of the Firstborn, written in heaven, in the Lamb's Book of Life. Nearly all the sects have passed through periods of persecution, torn for wonder, and have been by trial sore distress, but these are not to be considered absolute proofs of divine favor. Each sect had a measure of conscientiousness and zeal connected with its organization, which, however, were subsequently very generally lost in mere forms and ceremonies. The true church was to be known by her loyalty to the Lord and her willingness to endure hardness and persecution, not for some earthly creed, but on account of loyalty to the good tidings of great joy which shall be to all people. The center, the hub around which all true faith revolves, the church's one foundation, is the sacrificial merit of the death of Christ as a sin atonement, first for the church and ultimately for the whole world of mankind. This true church has been a self-sacrificing company from first to last. Whosoever will live godly in this present time shall suffer persecution. But these persecutions only lead the church of Christ near the walk of God and with the heavenly bridegroom, and cause it of all the greater interest in his second coming, and for her glorification, and the establishing of the kingdom to bless the world. Her cry goes up, how long? The Lord is my shepherd. No poet has ever served the souls of God's people so deeply as has the Psalm of David. And none of the Psalms has come closer to God's people in the way of comfort than has the very third. Jehovah God is the great shepherd of his flock, and Jesus, the great shepherd's son, fully represents Jehovah, the shepherd of his son. Jesus is carrying out the great program which Jehovah, the chief shepherd, mapped out at the very beginning, purposing it in himself before the foundation of the world. The provisions which the divine shepherd has made in sheep are abundant and sufficient. They shall not want. He will guide them to the green pastures for their instruction and righteousness, their development of character, their comfort. He will lead them to the precious waters of life, the quiet waters of truth which run deeply and come directly from the fountain. First, he'll introduce him to the fold of the Lord as his sheep. Next, his notice of the development of character, the giving of new life that he walked the narrow way, as a strength which the shepherd supplies, and under his protecting care. This is growth in grace, in knowledge, and in the Lord's likeness, which he must cultivate in order to maintain our position in his flock. Later, he notes the battle of the shadow of death, in which the entire human family has been walking ever since the fall. Father Adam and Mother Eve, created perfect in the image of God, and blessed with life everlasting so long as obedient, lost that grand position to disobedience, and began to descend into the valley of the shadow of death.
In this time of death, all of Adam's children have been born in sin, mistaken in iniquity, in sin that their mothers conceived them. The shadows of death have grown longer and deeper as the race has continued onward. As we see, oh, sometimes the shadows are deep, and rough seems the path to the goal. The Lord's people are not exempt from walking through this trial of the shadow of death. They have their full share of the trials and difficulties of life and its burdens. Indeed, they have more than others because they walk the narrow way in the footprints of their Lord, the way of self-sacrifice and obedience to the divine will, which brings on them the opposition of the world which knows them not, even as it knew not their master. Nevertheless, they have joy and comfort in the fellowship of the shepherd, whose rod and staff guide and comfort and protect them all the way, and eventually shall face them well in the house of the Lord forever, in the Father's house on high. There is a gate that stands ajar. There is much truth in this beautiful hymn, although it does not tell the entire gospel story. It merely pictures to us the high call in the church, styled by St. Paul, our heavenly calling. It does not tell of how, after the elect shall have entered the heavenly portals, God will use them in the blessing of the non-elect during the 1,000 years of Messiah's kingdom, nor the blessings of restitution to the human image and likeness of God that will constitute the salvation of the world. The gate to heavenly glory stands ajar to the gospel church alone. It was not open to those of ancient times, worthy though they were. Jesus, who left the heavenly courts and riches, and for our sake became poor, was the first to pass through the gate of God, referred to in this hymn. And the apostle says of Jesus, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. He refers to the glory of God's plan, which shone through the heavenly gates to Jesus, inspiring him to faithfulness in completing the sacrifice willingly undertaken. As a result of that sacrifice and that faithfulness unto death, in obedience to the Father's will, God has highly exalted him, far above angels and principalities and powers, to his own right hand. A radiance of hope, a glorious light, has shone out over all the earth from the cross of Christ. It shines through the Master's invitation, given directly and through the apostles. If any man will be my disciple, let him deny himself, and take up his cross daily and follow me. And then, where I am, there shall my disciple be. It is an invitation to suffer with Jesus for righteousness' sake, and eventually be glorified by the Father, even as was he. If we suffer with him, we shall also reign with him. Jesus himself sends the radiance into our hearts by his promise, to whom it overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and have sat down with my Father in his throne. The gate of John implies that the gate will close, and this the Bible declares. Only a little flock is expected by the Lord as a result of 1,800 years of special invitation to those willing to follow him in sacrifice, that they may share his kingdom and glory. He is not expecting the world to join him. He has said, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. But that kingdom will not be given until the little flock is completed. When completed, there will be no addition. Under another figure, the church is the Lord's espoused bride, and at his second coming, the marriage will take place. He will have but one bride, one joint heir in the kingdom, which is to bless the whole world. Our ever-present age. Not everybody, not even every Christian, has the experience so beautifully and forcefully outlined in this glorious hymn. It is an ideal, but one nevertheless that is attainable, one that has been attained by mature faith of God. If at the first these sublime heights and depths of faith and trust seem to be entirely beyond the aspiring child of God, nevertheless, let him not be discouraged. Christian character is a matter of development. The apostle likens new beginners to babes in sight and tells us that they need the sincere milk of the word, the pure, simple truths of the Bible, that they may grow thereby up to Christian manhood strength, development of character. The difficulty with many of us has been that we were not properly taught. We got the impression that the first step of surrendering our will to the Lord was the only step to be taken, that having turned from sin and accepted the divine standard, the remainder of our journey would be a series of victories and failures to the end. Now Bible students are realizing that this is a mistake, and they are searching for the path marked by the footsteps of Jesus and the apostles, and by their teachings for the church. Now we see that Christian character is to be developed by patient perseverance in well-doing, by study of the scriptures, by growth in grace and knowledge and love. Now we see that it is not only essential that we should be begotten of the Holy Spirit, but that afterwards we should bring forth the fruits of the Spirit in our daily lives, our words, our conduct, our thoughts. We see that the cultivation of the fruits of the Spirit is the main object of the Christian's life, and that without these well-developed, he would not be fit for the kingdom. He would not be fit to be a king to rule others, or a priest to teach and heal others, or a judge to reward or punish others, unless the fruits of the Holy Spirit had already been well developed in his own heart and life. The fruits of the Spirit are manifest: meekness, gentleness, patience, long-suffering, brotherly kindness, and love. If these things be in you and abound, like St. Peter, they shall make you to be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of the Lord. And thus an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly in the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is this kingdom class in an advanced stage of development whose experience of heart and life, of faith and obedience, are outlined in this musical hymn. Watching for the day. For 18 centuries, God's faithful people have been watching for the dawn of the glorious millennial day. They have realized under the Bible teachings the world is in darkness under the rule of the Prince of Darkness, who now exercises authority through its control of the children of disobedience. And these, by reason of ignorance and weakness, etc., are much more numerous than the children of obedience. The followers of Jesus, through the testimony of the prophets of the Old Testament, as well as through the words of Jesus and the apostles in the New Testament, have been expecting the kingdom of God's dear Son. They have never known how long the waiting time would be, but properly they have left the matter in the Lord's hands. From an earthly viewpoint, it has been a long while since sin entered the world, over 6,000 years, and it has been a long time since Jesus died for the sins of the world, over 1,800 years. But the time has not been long from the divine standpoint, the Lord declaring that 1,000 years is but as one day to him. Now we begin to see the dawn of the new dispensation and perceive that the 6 great days from Adam are already in the past. Chronologically, we have entered the great seventh day or Sabbath, which is the last 1,000 years. We see that we've been in that great Sabbath time more than 40 years. And behold, what wonderful years these have been, none like them ever before. Nearly all of our modern conveniences have come to us during this period. Gradually, man is attaining greater freedom from the effects of toil and sweat of faith, and has more time for self-development and improvement. The comforts of life are spreading in every direction, and the world is becoming very, very rich. By degrees, the wilderness is blossoming as the rose, and the solitary place is becoming like the Garden of Eden, as the Lord foretold. These blessings are not coming in some miraculous way, but nevertheless are of the Lord. He is lifting the veil before the human mind, and lo, as if by magic, our fields are yielding their increase. Artesian wells refresh the desert. Human skill is filling the earth with splendid flowers and fruits. Our streets and highways are replete with convenient arrangements for our comfort and transportation, and bring within our reach the treasuries of the whole world. With the eye of faith, we should be gathered flee away. Not yet, however, has Messiah's kingdom been fully established, nor has the Son of Righteousness risen with healing and seen to scatter all the miasma of sin and death. This will not be fully accomplished until the church should be completed and glorified with her Lord. For he has declared that he with himself is to be that Son of Righteousness which is to scatter the world's light and sin, so that all mankind may return to the image and likeness of God lost in Eden, redeemed at Calvary.